Good evening. We call this night Maundy Thursday. It was the night when Jesus celebrated the Passover with his disciples. It was also the night in which Jesus was arrested. It was the time in which his suffering towards the cross, this journey towards the cross, really began. And tonight on this Maundy Thursday, we celebrate communion together, the sacrament Jesus gave us to remember him. We also reflect upon his journey to the cross and on his suffering. Let's begin tonight with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, as we go on this journey with you and with the disciples, we pray, Lord, that we would have a sense of your presence with us. We pray, Lord, that you will help us to enter in to your suffering. Lord, as we die with you, may we also rise with you. Lord, we thank you that as we think about your sacrifice, we also anticipate your glory, your exaltation. But Lord, may this be a time in which we draw near to you. Open up our hearts and open up our minds, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Lent is, you might say, a spiritual journey. I can remember being here on Ash Wednesday. We had a special service. Now that seems like such a long time ago. But on Ash Wednesday, we received those ashes and we were reminded of our human frailty, our human weakness, and we really thought about humility. Well, during this Lent, we've been humbled even more than what we realized that we were going to be asked to do. But along this difficult Lenten journey this year, we know that Jesus has been walking with us every step of the way. And we know he is always with us. We know that his love surrounds us. So as we begin our time together tonight, we'll begin with the song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us, and invite you to sing along with us.
Thank you.
This evening, we celebrate communion together. We celebrate it, though, in a different kind of way. Here at church, those of us who are playing and singing will have communion, and then you in your homes can also join us in the sacrament. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, he took bread. After giving thanks to God, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant made in my blood. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." So when we take the bread and when we drink the cup, we proclaim the salvation work of our Lord Jesus Christ. We believe God meets us in the sacraments, holy acts in which his deeds elicit our response. In the supper, our Lord offers the bread and the cup to believers. And for believers, the sacrament guarantees our share in his death and in his resurrection, unites us to him and to one another. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Everything the Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me, I will never drive away." The gifts of God are for the people of God. So for those of you now joining us at home, I invite you to this time take your bread. And if you are with others, you can pass the bread to one another. As you do so, you can say to the people near you, "This is the body of Christ for you." I'll wait a moment now for you to go ahead and pass the bread in your homes, and then in a moment, we will eat together. Remember, we say as we take the bread and believe that this is the body of Christ given for you. Let's take and eat, remember and believe that the body of our precious Lord Jesus was given for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. Worshiping with us at home, go ahead and take the juice, or if you have not done so already, you may pour out that juice to one another. Get the juice ready, and if you're with others, you can take it, and as you pass it, you say to one another, "Now this is the blood of Christ shed for you." So take a moment and go ahead, prepare the juice, and then we will drink together in just a moment. Take now and drink. Remember and believe that the precious blood of our Savior Jesus Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. With thanksgiving, let us respond in prayer. With joy, we praise you, gracious God, for you have been so wonderfully kind and gracious to us. Even though, Lord, certainly we do not deserve it, but we give you thanks for Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who spilled his blood so that we could be spared from punishment like the true Passover lamb. So, Lord, tonight, help us remember your sacrifice. And in this evening in our worship, Lord, we pray that you will take us back to that Last Supper. Take us back, Lord, to that event as it happened. Your suffering, but for our redemption. Amen. If you have 6 candles at home, and you have not already lit them, I invite you now to go ahead, prepare your candles, and get them ready. After our meditation this evening, which will be coming in just a few moments, then there's going to be 6 different scripture readings. After each of those scripture readings, we'll blow out one of our candles, and as I blow out the candles here at church, you can join us with that and do so at home as things get progressively darker and darker as we remember the sacrifice of Jesus. In response to our communion, we will once again sing together.
Verses 1 through 5. It was just before the Passover feast, Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power, that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him.
Were you there when Jesus washed his disciples' feet? Well, I was. I am Peter, one of the disciples of Jesus. And let me tell you a moment, please, about our Passover night. But first, let me start off by saying that this has been quite an eventful week. It started just a few days ago on Sunday. And on Sunday, Jesus came into the city with us on the donkey in a triumphal entry, and the people were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord!" And we were getting so excited. And the disciples and I, we were talking, and we said, "Surely something big is going to happen. Will this be the time Jesus reveals himself as the Messiah to all?" Well, we've been waiting for this day. In fact, just recently, some of the other disciples and I were having a little bit of an argument about who would be Jesus' second in command. Now, of course, yes, it was a silly argument. Also silly because, of course, it was going to be me. But Jesus overheard what we were saying, and then Jesus said, "The one who will be the greatest is the servant of all." Of course, that sounds like something Jesus would say, doesn't it? But we were quickly disappointed. The very next day when we went back to the city, that's when Jesus overturned the tables in the temple. Surely you heard about that. And chased away the merchants. And we were left wondering, how is this going to help him raise popular support? Shouldn't he be going against those Gentile Romans? So once again, left confused. But then came Passover. I've been celebrating Passover my entire life. The disciples and I, we were excited about this and in a pretty good mood. But then Jesus started telling us more things that we didn't really understand. He was talking about his body and his blood, and he seemed really sad. But that really wasn't even the biggest event of the night. The story that I really wanted to share with you was something that happened before we started eating the Passover meal. And something that was so surprising to us. You know, of course, we've always known that Jesus is very humble. Jesus told us about how he was born in that manger. We know he grew up as a poor carpenter in Nazareth. And of course, Jesus chose us, regular fishermen, to be his disciples. Jesus has always been hanging around with people on the outside, the vulnerable ones, the the tax collectors or the prostitutes and the lepers. So, of course, Jesus has always been very humble. He's never done anything to exalt himself. But still, washing our feet. Now he has gone too far. You see, washing feet is a task so menial that we don't even ask our Jewish servants to do that job. Why, no one in authority would ever want to wash the feet of someone below them. It's unheard of. It's why it would be like if Caesar himself came to Galilee to wash my fishing nets. It just doesn't happen that way. Well, then, if things weren't awkward enough, he made it even more awkward when he said that he was doing this to set an example for us to follow. Now, sure, if I ever was asked to wash the feet of Jesus, surely I would. Just the other day, that woman wiped his feet with her hair. But who are these others that Jesus wants me to wash their feet? Is this why I have given up so much in my life, just so I could wash the feet of someone else? That's ridiculous. Well, the other disciples really didn't know what to do, and Jesus started washing their feet, and I wondered, isn't anyone going to say anything? Don't they believe that Jesus is the Messiah? Soon the other kings will be bowing down before Jesus, and they're letting Jesus wash their feet? Well, if the other disciples weren't going to say something, I would. So when Jesus came to me, this is what I said. I said, "No, Lord, you will never wash my feet." Then Jesus said one of those things that he says, always catching us off guard. And he said, "I have to do this if you were to have a part in me." Now, I admit I'm usually rather slow trying to figure out some of these things that Jesus is talking about. But as Jesus was talking and washing our feet, you know, there was something about this that reminded me of how it all began. See, it was about 3 years ago. My brother Andrew and I, at that time, we were disciples of John the Baptist. And I will always remember that day when I went down into the Jordan River, and the day when John baptized me. And I remember what John was talking about. He said, "This is a baptism of repentance." And he said, "Come now and be baptized so that you can be cleansed." So I realized, as I thought about this some more, of course, the important thing going on here is not that our feet would be clean. Of course, Jesus is saying that he wants our insides to be clean. And, you know, I've heard Jesus say before that he forgives sins and that he has the authority to forgive sins. So I started to think about that, and I thought to myself, it seems to me what Jesus is saying here is that he will humble himself so that I could be cleansed. And, you know, that does make some sense to me, but there's got to be a point where this humbleness comes to an end. There's got to be a point where Jesus stops doing these things and he becomes the king that he was meant to be, surely this is the low point. Surely this is enough suffering for Jesus. But I am left wondering. You see, all Jesus ever does is he gives more and more and more. And is there still something more? Is there something else that he has yet to do for us? Well, one thing is for sure. Now, I can't speak for the others, but I can speak for myself. And I know whatever that challenge is going to be, I am up for the challenge. In fact, even tonight, I said to Jesus, I said, listen, even if all the others fall away, I will stand with you. You know, Jesus has washed my feet. Now I will be faithful. I will be strong for him. Now hold on. What's that, Lord? You want us to pray with you in the garden? Okay, just a moment. It's getting late. Not really feeling like to pray right now, but if Jesus is asking us to pray, surely that is the least that I could do for him, right? You know? I am Peter, the rock. I will not fall away. I will not deny him. You know, I don't know about you, but I've been cleansed enough. Right? I can do it. Coming, Lord. Lord, I will pray with you.
John 18, 1 through 14. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was a garden, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it that you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said, and Judas the traitor was standing there with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put away your sword. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Then the detachment of soldiers, with its commander and the Jewish officials, arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders that it would be good if one man died for the people.
Thank you. Matthew 26, verses 69 through 75. Peter disowns Jesus. Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard, and a servant girl came to him. "You also were with Jesus of Galilee," she said. But he denied it before them all. "I don't know what you're talking about," he said. Then he went out to the gateway, where another servant girl saw him, and said to the people there, "This fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth." He denied it again with an oath, "I don't know the man." After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, "Surely you are one of them. Your accent gives you away." Then he began to call down curses, and he swore to them, "I don't know the man." Immediately a rooster crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken, "Before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly.
The chief priests, with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin made their plans. So they bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "You have said so," Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of?" But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now it was the custom at the festival to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the insurrectionists who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate, knowing it was out of self-interest that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead. "What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they shouted. "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified.
Was your incarnation As they were going out, they met a man from Cyrene named Simon, and they forced him to carry the cross. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed with gall. But after tasting it, he refused to drink it. When they had crucified him, they divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed the written charge against him: "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." In the same way, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders mocked him. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him, for he has said, 'I am the Son of God.'" In the same way, the robbers who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him.
Darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon, for the sun stopped shining. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion, seeing what had happened, praised God and said, "Surely, this was a righteous man." When all the people who had gathered to witness this sight saw what took place, they beat their breasts and went away. But all those who knew him, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things.
I see. Matthew 27, verses 57 through 60, the burial of Jesus. As evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance to the tomb and went away.
Joining with us tonight in our worship. I anticipate seeing you again on Easter morning. Go in peace.